There is no terrible way to win. There is only winning.
Let me drive. I will make a fool out of you.
Every one of us has to find a reason to do this. You do it because you're driven.
I was beginning to think I'd never be anything more than a piston-happy, lead-foot punk. Then this starts to happen.
Somebody put it in your mind you got to be perfect every time out or you're a failure. Well, forget that. Just forget it.
You ready to put away your toys and grow up? Are you ready to make more money in 1 year than your father made in his whole life? Are you ready to become a real race car driver?
When I won, it was probably the last time I ever felt pure victory.
Because I'm quicker than all of you.
And if you no longer go for a gap that exists, you're no longer a racing driver.
Hell, isn't that what we're in this for? To stare death in the face and to cheat it? Come on, there's nobility in that. It's like being knights.
No pressure. Nobody breathing down my back just driving because I left it pure.
A lot of people go through life doing things badly. Racing is important to men who do it well. When you're racing, it's life. Anything that happens before or after, just waiting.
I just hope when you do, then I'm there to see it.
Racing. That's the name of the game, isn't it? Win or lose, put up a show.
Fine. Then let's race.
Hi, I'm Tom Ingram, and you're listening to Downforce Radio.
Hi, I'm Jacques Villeneuve, you're listening to Downforce Radio.
Hi, I'm Bruno Senna, you're listening to Downforce Radio.
Hi, I'm Chris Hoy, and you're listening to Downforce Radio.
Hi, I'm Landon Norris, and you're listening to Downforce Radio.
You're listening to Race Day Live on Downforce UK, brought to you by Clapham North MOT, Motorsport Days Live, Stopwatch Hospitality, and Trade Price Cars.
The waiting is over. It is time to go racing in the 10th round of the Motorsport UK British Car Championships for 2019 in the IAME classes here in the beautiful sunshine here at the Three Sisters Circuit in the northwest of England in Ashton-in-Makerfield, just outside the city of Wigan. And what an absolutely incredible race we are going to have in each of our four categories across the IAME classes. Junior and Senior X30, IAME Cadet and Mini X30, with the 10th round of 12 in the 2019 British Championships set to play out, with not even the wisp of a cumulonimbus in sight in the gorgeous blue sky across the circuit. It is absolutely roasting. Air temperature 28 degrees Celsius, so if you do your mathematics, that's probably going to make the circuit itself round about 43, 44 degrees Celsius in track temperature. It is an absolute scorcher. Jake Sanson here from my position overlooking the start finish line on the main straight, overlooking that first sweeping chicane section that leads up to the valley and then up towards the old pit straight. It is there where the drivers are currently positioned on the Junior X30 grid, and they are obviously in their formation positions. The photographers are down there getting the great shots of the racers in position, with championship contender Caden McQueen fighting his corner in the two heats earlier today, and he is there in pole position for the Croc Promotion squad on the inside line of the front row, with Oliver Gray, championship leader, without drop scores taken into account, alongside him on the front row of the grid. These two are the implacable rivals of Junior X30 in the British Championship in 2019, and boy oh boy are they going to give us an absolutely fantastic show here at Three Sisters. Josh Rowledge making the switch across to the Mick Barrett Racing team for the rest of the 2019 campaign. His third position on the grid after two very solid results across the heat. And Tom Levin for the Mark Litchfield Racing team lines up on the second row of the grid beside him. In fifth position on the grid, it is Georgi Dimitrov, the man who stormed the crows at VF International the first round of the championship. And Tyler Reed lines up sixth position for M Sport. Six different teams in the top six positions on the grid. That is very exciting stuff and proof of just how competitive it is in Junior X30. Seventh on the grid is Sam Hawthorne. The Japanese talent Douglas Bulger lines up in a very competitive eighth place. And the field is lining up and around the circuit now on their formation lap. So here we go, it's time to go racing. We'll talk you through the grid in full. Caden McQueen and Oliver Gray, Josh Rowledge and Tom Levin, Georgi Dimitrov and Tyler Reed, from Sam Hawthorne and Douglas Bulger, then Aaron Walker and Freddie Spindlow, Archie Walker and Zach Meakin, then it is Daryl Taylor who runs in position in front of Josh McLean and Alessandro Serenetti, Will Murdoch and Dan Butterworth, Kalai Atkins and Marcus Littlewood, from Joe Taylor, Blake Anglis, Archie Mace, Aidan Neat, Dan Ginchard, James Walker, Kasper Skuza, Aaron Walker, Oscar Joyce, Alex Moody, Oliver Duffel, Ivan Lomliev and Max Meir. 32 drivers on the starting grid, and they will all battle for supremacy around the circuit as the competitors are trying to get themselves up to speed in the early stage of proceedings. It will be a very tough race ahead of us, and obviously we'll keep an eye on the virtual championship points as they are played out as well. Although it looks to me as though, thanks to the performances of Caden McQueen today, we're going to get a championship showdown at Wilton Mill. No champion is likely to be crowned here today, but what an amazing fight it's going to be when we get there. This final could well determine how that championship season finale at Wilton Mill is played out. It's going to be one heck of a show. So the drivers are building themselves up to a crescendo in the two rows. So as they come out of the final hairpin, we'll get underway. Caden McQueen, Oliver Gray, Josh Rowledge and Tom Leban in the first two rows of the grid, from Dimitrov, Reed, Hawthorne, Douglas Bulger, Aaron Walker and Freddie Spindlow. The engine revs rise. Jake Sanson with you for this final of the weekend here at Three Sisters, and it's a false start straight away. Well, that's really given us a little bit of a heart breather there, as the drivers thought the race was underway. So did I, but a few drivers were out of position, so they're going to have to go round and do it all again, as if the tension wasn't high enough for this first final of the day here on this very hot and very intense Sunday afternoon. The timing screen's just updated in front of me, actually, and it tells me that the air temperature is not 28 degrees. In fact, it is 30. So obviously those two couple of degrees make a massive difference, but 30 degrees Celsius heat here at Three Sisters in Wigan is going to make things very intense for the British Car Championships. Round 10 of the IAME Junior X30 British Championship season for 2019. Plenty of podium finishes over the course of the season. Race winners are plenty too. But now we're getting to the business end of the championship showdown. Caden McQueen on pole position with Oliver Gray alongside him. The two title protagonists on the front row of the grid here at Three Sisters. Josh Rowledge and Tom Leban, Georgia Dimitrov and Tyler Reed, Sam Hawthorne, Douglas Bulger, Aaron Walker and Freddie Spindlow in the top 10. Jake Sanson to talk you round the final here at Three Sisters. And what a battle it is going to be. Round 10 of the 12-round championship. Are we ready to race? We certainly are. And we're away! Down to the first corner. No problem at all for Caden McQueen holding the inside line. Oliver Gray trying to come around the outside but not able to get into the lead. So Caden McQueen holds it nice and steady through the first couple of corners. They knit their way through the chicane. One or two drivers running wide, but it looks as though everybody facing the right way. And as they come onto the old pit straight for the first time, it is Caden McQueen in front of Oliver Gray, and that looks like the Chaos Sport has leapt forward. Now, who is that that's charged the way through the field? Freddie Spindlow's made up about three places by the look of it, but up into third place, that is the Mick Barrett racing cart of Josh Rowledge. Then it is Tom Leban. So a nice easy start. Dimitrov is there still in front of Tyler Reed. So the top six retain their positions. And Alessandro Serenetti is trying to cut his way through the field further back. But a nice move already as the drivers have started to charge their way through. Josh Rowledge is already starting to work with Oliver Gray to close back up to Caden McQueen. Tom Leban there in fourth position. Then it is Dimitrov in front of Reed, Hawthorne, Bulger, Aaron and Archie Walker from Freddie Spindlow, Zach Meakin, Daryl Taylor and Alessandro Serenetti at the end of the first lap. It's all clean at the moment as the drivers are racing their way through, trying to gain places, trying to maintain momentum. But at this precise moment in time, it is Caden McQueen who leads the way up in front. So Alessandro Serenetti has got an issue with his transponder. It seems to have failed, so he's going to be nipping in and out of the timing screen through the course of this final. So he is being transponded the old-fashioned way. So across the line comes our race leader, Caden McQueen, two laps down and has an advantage to Gray, Rowledge and Leban. Rowledge is going to have a look up the inside and makes the place on Oliver Gray. So Rowledge into second place. Nice overtake there into the first corner. And a very neat and tidy manoeuvre it was indeed. So McQueen continues to hold the pace, but now in a second is Josh Rowledge for his new team, the Mick Barrett Racing Squad. And in front of Oliver Gray now, the GP plate, who did such a fantastic job yesterday. Now Oliver Gray is going to have to dig deep and find some more pace here, as both Caden McQueen and Josh Rowledge are very quick around this circuit. Still clean as a whistle through the field. Drivers obviously realising that it's a 15-minute race plus the additional bonus lap. And they all know that you can't win the race in the first couple of laps, but you can definitely lose it. So as it stays like this on full points, Oliver Gray would move up to 589, Caden McQueen to 572, and Dimitrov would drop to third place on 564. Rowledge is going to get himself back into fourth place in the Drivers' Championship without drop scores taken into account if things stand as they are. So he's pushing very hard and is already gaining ground on Caden McQueen, who seems to be in conservation mode, trying to keep things nice and easy at the moment, because obviously it's a very long race and in very high temperatures the drivers will need to be keeping their focus very carefully. It's hotter than it was yesterday even, and the wind seems to have completely died down. So it's going to be a very tough race as the laps continue to count down around the circuit. Drivers are going to find it ridiculously tough to cope with. Up to that first chicane. And still Josh Rowlidge breathing down the neck of Caden McQueen. Leban has a look at Oliver Gray for third position. Is not able to get there. Onto the back of them comes Tyler Reed, who has moved his way up into fifth position. Sixth place now is Dimitrov. Then it's Hawthorne, Bolger, Spindlow, Aaron Walker in front of Archie Walker. And then Zach Meakin and Alessandro Serenetti from Daryl Taylor, Josh McLean, James Walker, Blake Anglis, Joe Taylor, Daniel Butterworth and Casper Skuza. So some very exciting racing at the front end of the field. Drivers still just trying to edge their way around the circuit. They've been complaining all day about just how intense the heat is. It is the hottest round of the 2019 championship without a shadow of a doubt, breaking into 30 degrees Celsius air temperature. So now the competitors are going to work for it. On the inside, nice move there from Josh Rowlidge as he takes the lead from Caden McQueen, but it's still very early doors and he will know that to win this race, he's got to now hold him at bay for over 11 minutes. Because of course, once the time runs down to zero, they've got the additional extra lap to contend with as well. Caden McQueen not going to be led in this race. He gets back up the inside and Oliver Gray slips through as well to get into second position. So Caden McQueen retakes the lead, having lost it for all of about 400 metres. And now Gray's going to make his bid for the lead. He gets through the left-hander into Luna and he leads the race. Fantastic timing from Oliver Gray. And we have three lead changes over the course of one lap. First, it was Rowlidge who hit the front, then McQueen who took it back. Now McQueen and Rowlidge are going to go past Gray down the main straight. McQueen retakes the lead, Rowlidge at a second and Gray third. And look at the train that's now developing as a result of this squabble. All of these drivers wanting to be the one who leads the race from the front. Caden McQueen does not want to be overtaken here. And as he goes down the old pit straight, he has got Rowlidge and Gray breathing down his neck. In fourth is Leban. Then it's Reed, Dimitrov, who has been battling away with the man in sixth position who's got through. That is Freddie Spindlow, who was on the podium yesterday, of course, in the final. And he's been trying to fight his way back through after a difficult day at the office so far today. But he is making his way up the order and making places forward. So, Caden McQueen is now your new race leader. Josh Rowlidge in second place. He's going to go for the move up the inside again, and Gray's going to go with him. A late lunge from Gray. Rowlidge to the lead, Gray to second, McQueen down to third. He's getting very frustrated at all this overtaking up at the front end of the field. He just wants to run at the front without difficulty, but now Rowlidge and Gray are giving him a hard time. Here comes McQueen up at a second place. Gets the move back on the inside of Oliver Gray. Nice bit of driving. Tom Leban has now left the rest of the train behind, and he is tucked in behind. It's a four-way fight for the victory. Never mind a three. And now Gray is again trying to edge closer to McQueen, but McQueen is going to have to go for the move on Rowlidge going into the first corner by the look of things. The momentum is definitely with him. A warning flag has gone the way of Tom Leban in fourth position. I'm not sure what for. Here comes McQueen up the inside. Makes the bid to get through into the lead again. Lots of great lead changes in this race. It's like the Indy 500 of British karting at the moment. Up and over the valley and in towards the old pit straight. This is going to be an absolutely sensational race, and we're not even halfway through it yet. Up the inside, that is the move, as Tom Leban has to concede to Oliver Gray. Gray had originally lost out. Now Gray gets back through to the inside and reclaims third position from Tom Leban. In fifth place, we've got a good battle too. Tyler Reed in front of Freddie Spindlow. Then it is Georgi Dimitrov and Aaron Walker from Hawthorne, Bolger, Meakin, Archie Walker, Serenetti and Taylor. Here come the leaders again. Rowlidge is going to have a run on Caden McQueen. He goes back to the inside line. Is there enough room for Gray to get there too? Yes, there is. McQueen has to settle for third again. Absolutely terrific. They're going to keep this battle going in this mode all the way to the finish line by the look of things. All it takes is one driver to go for the lead. And there is an absolute onslaught as all three of these drivers, Rowlidge, Gray and McQueen, want to go into the closing stages in the lead of the race, because this circuit's got plenty of long straights, but also good defensive opportunities. Whoever leads with two laps to go is going to have a great chance to sew up the victory. But all three of these drivers are going to have a big show on their hands to get to the front of the field. So, back to the front is Josh Rowlidge. Gray is now defending from Caden McQueen. McQueen goes the long way round, sweeps around the outside of Oliver Gray. Lovely move, and Caden McQueen gets back in a second place. Brilliant bit of racecraft on the outside of the first corner. And absolutely brilliant it was indeed to get back in a second position. Now down the pit straight, having a look at Josh Rowledge. He's not quite close enough to throw it to the inside of the right apex. He's got the pair of lefts now into the S's and up on the run to Luna once again. So a really exciting battle. Here's the 42, Cade McQueen all over the back of Josh Rowledge, having fought his way back at his second position. Gray going super defensive to the inside of the first corner and losing out. But watch for Cade McQueen now as he makes his bid to get past Josh Rowledge, who protects the inside line. He's done it once. Can he do it again? Yes, he does. Cade McQueen lightning round the outside. Absolutely superb from Cade McQueen. He pulls off the same move in two consecutive laps. Once for second, then for first. Absolutely incredible. So Cade McQueen hits the front once again, and the championship fight is definitely coming the way of the crop promotion driver. He's been a club champion multiple times over. He really wants to win the Junior X30 British Championship. Meanwhile, Tom Leban is under some pressure now from Freddie Spindlow, who's got himself up the order. It's no longer a four-way fight, it's a five-way fight. Freddie Spindlow has joined the cavalry, and down the straight, he's in command of his faculties now. To the inside line, Cade McQueen, very sensible. He holds the middle of the circuit on the way down to the braking zone as we enter the second half of the race. And the new boy, Aidan Neat, has been given a warning flag. Now, Aidan Neat has jumped ship from IAME Cadet in the runner-up position in the championship standings to come and do Junior X30. He was brilliant yesterday, up in the top 10. Really struggled in qualifying this morning, and ever since then has had a real fight in his hands. But he's definitely got the speed and commitment to make the progress forward. So we'll see over the course of the next couple of meetings how Aidan Neat gets on. But he is definitely showing his credentials in Junior X30. Out of the final turn, the leaders are coming towards us once more. McQueen in front of Rowledge. Here comes Tom Leban making the bid on the inside of Oliver Gray as McQueen defends to the inside line. Leban gets through, Spindlow gets through. Gray in big trouble, down to fifth position for the moment. But Oliver Gray very nearly lost an awful lot more than that. So he drops into fifth position to the back of the queue as again Cade McQueen has to defend valiantly to Josh Rowledge. There's 5 minutes to go and McQueen is defending. This is absolutely incredible, the battle going on at the front of the field. And this is incredibly early into the race for Cade McQueen to be in defensive mode. But he does not want to let Josh Rowledge through on the inside. It's going to take a brave move to make that happen. We've got yellow flags on the far side of the circuit. It looks like one of the Coles carts has come off the circuit, and I think that's James Walker. James Walker appears to be in trouble, so James Walker out of the race, unfortunately. Meanwhile, Freddie Spindlow has made the move on Tom Leban to get into third position. Yellow flags fly, so they can't overtake on that point of the circuit. And as they go down the old pit straight, we have got an absolute thriller in progress right now. Through the right, through the double apex left. And it looks like we got two carts off the circuit at that point. It's not just James Walker who's out of the race. We have another one in the war zone there as well. I think it's Casper Skuza. Archie Mason, Oscar Joyce are no longer involved either. I'm not sure either of them were involved in the... I think they were off on the first lap, in fact, Mason Joyce. So they're out of it as Josh Rowledge is desperate to try and keep Cade McQueen further up the road. McQueen is defending. Rowledge is trying to signal to him, what are you doing? We need to keep pushing away from the guys behind us. So Freddie Spindlow up to third place. And they are giving a lot of pressure now to McQueen and Rowledge. Rowledge is trying to urge McQueen, stop defending. Let's pull away from the rest of the field. And then it's a two-man fight for the victory. A side-by-side for fifth position and around the outside. That is a lovely bit of driving from Tyler Reed. He has made mincemeat of Oliver Gray on the inside there. And now we've got a fight for seventh place as Dimitrov gets to the inside of Walker. What a squabble going on there. That is Dimitrov, Walker, Hawthorne, Bulger, Meakin. And they are just about able to run side-by-side as they come through together. So Aaron Walker hanging on to it, and it's 2x2, hurrah, behind Archie Walker and Georgie Dimitrov, McLean and Meakin, all in there together, squabbling away. Bulger seems to have lost a bit of ground in the middle of all of that, but terrific racing just behind the leaders now as well. And it looks as though we got a nice move from Sam Hawthorne up the inside there, making the lunge on Will Murdoch. So good overtaking moves through the field. The top three have now started to stretch away. McQueen, Rowledge and Spindlow. Freddie Spindlow's joined the cavalry for victory now up front as Leban and Reed are struggling to stay with them. Aaron Walker's really getting a bit of a hassle from Archie Walker as well as they battle over seventh place across the start-finish line with 2.5 minutes to go. There's not going to be too long before a big move. Up the inside goes Rowledge. McQueen holds him at bay. They're still side by side, but eventually he has to concede and McQueen holds on to the lead. But Rowledge is getting impatient, and that's why, because he's got Spindlow and Leban all over the back of him, and they are third and fourth trying to get through in a second place. Rowledge doesn't want to do this dance anymore. McQueen still defending to the inside line, and that is making a four-way fight become a six-way fight. Here comes Tyler Reed and Oliver Gray. They are going to close up as well now. So this is going to go. Oh, contact! The two carts have come together there, unfortunately. And that is Freddie Spindlow and Caden McQueen, I think. So McQueen has come off there. No, Freddie Spindlow's still your leader. It's Rowledge and McQueen. Rowledge and McQueen have tangled. So that really has been a big problem there into the run to Luna. And that is devastating for both drivers. Both McQueen and Rowledge down the order. Rowledge down to 19th, Caden McQueen to 23rd. And that means that Freddie Spindlow is now fighting for the victory with Tom Leban, Tyler Reed and Oliver Gray. Is Oliver Gray going to receive a get out of jail free card? Because he's now one place away from the podium once more. But incredibly, Rowledge and McQueen have tangled on the left-hand flick on the way to Luna on lap 18. And that is devastating for both drivers' charges in this race. But for McQueen in particular, it's devastating in his fight for the championship. So now Freddie Spindlow leads the race. Oliver Gray sat in fourth position. Doesn't have to panic here. He just needs to stay with the leading three, who begin the 20th lap. Spindlow leading, Leban and Reed. Oliver Gray in fourth position. Archie Walker has now come up to fifth position as a result of all of that shenanigans. Josh McLean is next up. Then it's Aaron Walker, Zach Meakin, Georgi Dimitrov. And rounding out the top 10 now is Joe Taylor. So the fight for victory is about to get into its real scenario. Out of Luna Bend. And the top four are now going to be battling with two laps to go around Three Sisters. It's going to be an absolute nail biter to the checkered flag. Here they come across the line. And now there's going to be a massive bit of defense from Leban as he tries to keep Tyler Reed at bay. Oliver Gray still sat there in fourth position. Doesn't need to do much hard work here to get himself a chance of a move up the order. It's going to get pretty spicy. Caden McQueen trying to make up places, and he has done so there. McQueen has got through past Will Murdoch, and the next man up the road, unbelievably, is Josh Rowledge. So McQueen might still have another battle to have with Josh Rowledge in this one. Freddie Spindlow, Tom Leban, Tyler Reed, and in fourth place, Oliver Gray. So this is going to be a really exciting final lap, but Freddie Spindlow for KR Sport is just trying to hang on to it after the misery of qualifying this morning. He's now in a position to win the race. Meanwhile, Tyler Reed is trying to hang on in front of Oliver Gray. And for fifth position, Archie Walker's defending valiantly to keep hold of his fifth place from McLean and Walker. That is Aaron Walker we're discussing there, of course. Onto the old pit straight. Tom Leban's got one or two more chances to go for the inside of Freddie Spindlow, but he needs to make up some time. He can't just throw it up the inside and hope it sticks. He's got to know that he's got the opportunity on Freddie Spindlow, but Spindlow may have done enough here. He checks over his left shoulder. Tom Leban is still there, but from the brink of defeat, Freddie Spindlow has pulled it out of the bag, kept himself in the fight, made up places, and he's going to take the victory from 10th on the grid. Freddie Spindlow wins the final here at Three Sisters. Absolutely terrific. Second place for Tom Leban. Third for Reed, fourth for Ollie Gray, and fifth for Archie Walker on his comeback to the British Championship. Brilliant bit of racing there. Josh McLean is sixth in front of Aaron Walker, Georgi Dimitrov, Zach Meakin and Joe Taylor. What heroic racing. Absolutely phenomenal. Daryl Taylor is 11th. Alessandro Serenetti fights back to 12th position in front of Ivan Lomliev, who comes through from 31st on the grid to 13th. Dan Butterworth is 14th in front of Aidan Neat, who made up several places too to P15. Douglas Bulger is only 16th on this occasion. Max Meir and Dan Ginshard making up places. But Josh Rowledge and Caden McQueen, after their clash, only just find their way into the top 20. Will Murdoch and Aaron Walker, that's as Walker, the number 80, Sam Hawthorne and Carly Atkins, Oliver Duffel, Alex Moody and Blake Anglis complete the field, with retirement sadly for Marcus Littlewood, James Walker, Casper Scusa, Archie Mason, Oscar Joyce. Freddie Spindlow wins, but the title fight has taken a dramatic twist here at Three Sisters. Wow. I'm not sure anybody expected that to happen. That clash between the two leading protagonists in the race. Absolutely incredible between Caden McQueen and Josh Rowledge on the way up towards Luna. And there's going to be a long conversation about that one afterwards for sure. But the Junior X30 final has now taken its final bow. And it's Senior X30 up next. Predict a winner? Well, it's definitely going to be tight. Danny Curl doesn't seem to be as fast as he was yesterday. But he definitely has the ability to win. Is he going to make it 2 out of 2? We'll find out shortly.
There is no terrible way to win. There is only winning.
Let me drive. I won't make a fool out of you.
Every one of us has to find a reason to do this. You do it because you're driven.
I was beginning to think I'd never be anything more than a piston-happy, lead-foot punk. Then this starts to happen.
Somebody put it in your mind you got to be perfect every time out or you're a failure. Well, forget that. Just forget it.
You ready to put away your toys and grow up? Are you ready to make more money in 1 year than your father made in his whole life? Are you ready to become a real race car driver?
When I won, it was probably the last time I ever felt pure victory.
Because I'm quicker than all of you.
And if you no longer go for a gap that exists, you're no longer a racing driver.
I mean, hell, isn't that what we're in this for? To stare death in the face and to cheat it? Come on, there's nobility in that. It's like being knights.
No pressure. Nobody breathing down my back just driving because I left it pure.
A lot of people go through life doing things badly. Racing is important to men who do it well. When you're racing, it's life. Anything that happens before or after, just waiting.
I just hope when you do, that I'm there to see.
Racing. That's the name of the game, isn't it? Win or lose, put up a show.
Fine. And let's race.
Turn on. Let's go 10 out of 10. Funky Rebel music on the radio again. Tune in. Let's go 10 out of 10. Funky Rebel music on the radio again. Turn on. Let's go 10 out of 10. Funky Rebel music on the radio again. Tune in. Let's go 10 out of 10. Funky Rebel music on the radio again. Turn on. Let's go 10 out of 10. Funky Rebel music on the radio again. Tune in. Let's go 10 out of 10. Funky Rebel music on the radio again.
Hi, I'm Tom Ingram, and you're listening to Downforce Radio.
Hi, I'm Jacques Villeneuve, you're listening to Downforce Radio.
Hi, I'm Bruno Senna, you're listening to Downforce Radio.
Hi, I'm Chris Hoy, and you're listening to Downforce Radio.
Hi, I'm Landon Norris, and you're listening to Downforce Radio.
You're listening to Race Day Live on Downforce UK, brought to you by Clapham North MOT, Motorsport Days Live, Stopwatch Hospitality, and Trey Price Cars.
A really exciting battle in this race as Danny Kerr leads Mark Kimber. They continue to fight their way further forward. Hodgson in third position. Fourth place is now Sean Butcher. But Danny Kerr is trying to fight his way back into the lead of the race from Mark Kimber. So Mark Kimber leads the race here in front of Danny Kerr. And he continues to charge his way forward. So there's going to be a really exciting battle throughout this race. They will go over the top of the valley. And pushing very hard indeed. So really exciting battle as they come up the pit straight. The old one that is. And then through to the hairpin once again. A very exciting battle. Still in the offing for these three or four drivers up at the front end of the field. Butcher now down behind Hodgson in front of Ravenscroft. And the number 10 in there, that is Rory Hudson. So they continue to battle forward. Some really exciting battles. Oh, that's a lovely move from Alex Wang, who tries to make the move there on Eduardo Cossetang, who goes out wide. So the Asian contenders in the field, the Singaporean and the Filipino, battling away together. But Mark Kimber in front of Danny Kerr. 11 minutes plus a bit of change and the additional bonus lap to go. And Mark Kimber leads Danny Kerr. A very exciting battle in this British Championship field as Danny Kerr is still trying to make as many points up as he possibly can. He'll finish on 511 if this race finishes as it is for the run to the final round of the championship. And on dropped scores, that would definitely put Danny Kerr very much in the lead of the Drivers' Championship. So this is going to be a very exciting run for Mark Kimber as he tries to hold on in front of Danny Kerr across the line again, having missed the round of the championship for his sports car commitment. But Mark Kimber still battling when he can. Danny Kerr right there behind him in second place. Hodgson, Butcher, Ravenscroft, Hudson, Turner and Pendlebury. They come onto the old pit straight once again. And still, Danny Kerr trying to edge past Mark Kimber. But at the moment, they just need to start disappearing away from the rest of the field. Hodgson's going to be a tough one to battle with. Up into fourth position, as we know. Sean Butcher, Clayton Ravenscroft trying to stay with him. And then in sixth place, it is Hudson from Turner, Pendlebury, Pritchard, Williams, Morgan Porter, Cole Kilner, Jack Gordon, Nelson King, Archie Tillett, Louis Westover and Jensen Brown, with Alexander Wang and Derek Morgan in front of Matt Armstrong and Eduardo Cossetang. So across they come into the first corner once again. No change at the front end of the field. Mark Kimber still hanging on to this advantage from Danny Kerr. They go over the valley into the S's. Very high curves at that point of the course as well. So then they come onto the old pit straight. And again, Danny Kerr is close enough to challenge Mark Kimber. But this is not the point in the race to really go for it. We're into the second third of the race, as it were. 5.5 minutes gone. And another 9.5 plus the additional lap to go. But they are starting to edge away from Oliver Hodgson. This might be the moment Danny Kerr will want to try and make his break up the inside of Mark Kimber to take the lead. They come off the hairpin at Luna. Down the main straight. And are they still going to continue to edge away? Yes, Danny Kerr is playing the long game here. He does not want to go for a big, bold manoeuvre. Yesterday, that was the case for his main rival in yesterday's competition, Clayton Ravenscroft. He made a big dive on the inside of the first corner and ended up spat off to the sidelines, losing places. Now, they're going to try and push further forward up at the front end of the field. Ravenscroft is there in the mix. He's in fifth position, chasing down the Australian and his teammate, Sean Butcher. But Danny Kerr is trying to edge away with Mark Kimber. He's not going to go for an overtake anytime soon. He's going to wait for the last two laps. But he just wants to pull away and make that gap as big as possible back to Oliver Hodgson in third. So they're going to continue to push up front. Danny Kerr still edging away with Mark Kimber. It's great to see three sisters back in the British Car Championship calendar again for the first time since 2013 at national level. And it really does deserve its place on the calendar. The IAME competitors giving an absolutely incredible show here. Up into the hairpin once again. Tight through the pair of left apexes. Kimber still in front of Kerr, but they're not really able to stretch away from Hodgson. Hodgson, if anything, is actually closing in on them at the moment. Butcher and Ravenscroft are not a million miles away either. In fact, Butcher is giving Hodgson a bit of a hurry up. And the fastest man on the track in the first sector was Ravenscroft, just in front of Butcher in terms of their times. So it is definitely not quite working out the way Danny Kerr wanted. He wanted to pull away with Mark Kimber at the front end of the field, but it doesn't look like it's going to go that way. With Thomas Turner now in sixth position behind Clayton Ravenscroft, it looks as if Turner is going to head into the final round of the championship before dropped scores. 4 points clear of Ravenscroft's tally. So this is going to be a very important race for Ravenscroft to make up a few more points, especially now that in behind him is Thomas Turner. So Ravenscroft and Turner, fifth and sixth, battling for the championship as well as the victory. So out of the final turn, Kimber's still in front of Danny Curl. Curl is still pushing hard, but he wants to build a gap. And now he's going to go for the lead. He's not going to wait around any longer. He dives to the inside, gets the place, and retakes the lead of this race. So Danny Curl is up to first position. He's bid his time, he's taken his time about it, but he's got himself into the lead. And now, once Danny Curl has got into the lead of a race in 2019 in the British Kart Championship Senior X30 contention, there's very little chance of drivers finding a way through. He's been up at the top three pretty much every single race this year. So he's got a massive points haul. But Sean Butcher's now edging closer to Oliver Hodgson for third. So I think Kimber may actually have a bit of a mission on his hands if Butcher can get past Oliver Hodgson. But here comes Kimber. He's going to try again up on the inside line and makes the move on Danny Curl. Curl is playing the long game. He lets him go as we go into the second half of the race. So Danny Curl is hanging on in hope that he's going to get a little bit of support from Oliver Hodgson in third position, as Mark Kimber has pulled out about a couple of kart lengths on Danny Curl just through the natural flow of momentum. And Sean Butcher dives to the inside in the hairpin, makes the move on Oliver Hodgson and into third place. A great run from the Australian there, and that puts him into third place. Meanwhile, behind them, with Hodgson in fourth place, we've got Ravenscroft and Turner now being caught by Alex Pendlebury, who is a bit of a circuit specialist here, loves this place very much indeed. And he's now the fastest driver of all in the second sector. So there's a little bit of a gap developing up at the front end of the field. Kimber has pulled out a little bit on Danny Curl, but Curl needs to get back on the horse here quickly. And to be fair, in the third sector, he was quicker than Kimber by over a tenth of a second. Now he's got another chance down the old pit straight. Will he make the move immediately? Well, he's going to try and edge away with Mark Kimber again. So Kimber having retaken the lead of the race. Danny Curl slots back into second place. Butcher now third from Hodgson. Ravenscroft and Turner. Pendlebury in seventh place. Eighth is now the privateer. That's Teddy Pritchard-Williams. And then it is Morgan Porter up to ninth in front of Hudson. Jack Gordon, Cole Kilner, Tillett, Westover, King, Brown, Armstrong, Alexander Wang, Gus Lawrence and Derek Morgan. A very exciting field still. And incredibly, only one retirement, and that is Lee Chamberlain, who's had some mechanical problems and pulled off the circuit three laps ago. So some really exciting runs in the midfield, some good overtakes, some good driver changes up through the field. The man who's made the most progress through the field is Matt Armstrong, who's made up five places, as too, incidentally, has Alex Pendlebury, who is now, of course, in seventh place, started this race in 12th, and we're now slowly developing a seven-cart train for the lead of the race. It's not quite as tight as it was in the latter stages of the Junior X30 final earlier on, but in Senior X30, these guys are going to take their time about building up momentum. So they are still together, the top seven in a line. Danny Curl is about two cart lengths behind Kimber, which is about 3/10 of a second. Another 3/10 back is Butcher, another 3/10 back is Hodgson, another 4/10 back is Ravenscroft, another 3/10 back is Turner, and then another 10th of a second back is Alex Pendlebury. So they're still very close indeed, these seven. Very tight together. And there's a nice little train building for 10th place now as well, behind Porter and Hudson, led by, I think that's Louis Westover, who's made his way up the order. Indeed he has. Westover's made his way up into, no, sorry, that is Rory Hudson in 10th place, in front of Gordon, Kilner, then Westover, Tillett and Nelson King. So a very exciting train of drivers. Jensen Brown is still in the mix there as well, for Dan Holland Racing in there as well. But still, the leaders are just ticking down laps, trying to make sure it all comes together. There was a little bit of a tangle in the first corner. So two drivers getting a little bit too close together. I think that was Cole Kilner making a lunge up the inside of Jack Gordon into the first corner. And they had a little bit of a touch. But I don't know if that's going to cause more issues than it solves, or if they've just sorted it out between them already. So Kimber, Curl, Butcher, Hodgson, Ravenscroft, Turner and Pendlebury. They make their way through to the final hairpin, out of Luna and back onto the home stretch again. Very fast part of the circuit. One of the fastest circuits in Great Britain. So the drivers continue to battle, and it's defensive mode from Mark Kimber. Danny Curl trying to go around the outside, but with 2.5 minutes to go, Kimber is defending. That's very early again for Mark Kimber. So this is going to be an interesting one. If he can continue to hold that line, then it's going to be a very tough one. Two more retirements to add to the list, unfortunately. Rufus Hunt is out of the race for Strawberry Racing, and also Mick Barrett driver Matthew Hudson is out of the race. So two more, unfortunately, coming a cropper in this battle. But the leading battle is the one we want to watch. It is Kimber, Curl, Butcher, Hodgson, Ravenscroft, Turner and Pendlebury. Seven of them in a line. And so far, Mark Kimber is feeling that the defensive role is the one to play, because Danny Curl is going to give him a big push to that first corner. So Danny Curl is not quite able to get past Mark Kimber. If he can just hold that inside line of the first corner, it seems as though he's got enough momentum for the rest of the lap to be able to hang on. But just how impatient are Sean Butcher and Oliver Hodgson going to get? We're getting into the last 2 minutes of time. A minute and a half to go, plus the additional lap. So this is going to be tight, and Kimber knows it. Danny Curl is going to throw every trick out of the book he possibly can in order to overhaul Mark Kimber. But he knows now that Kimber's going to defend to the inside line. So what can Danny Curl do in response? Here they go, down the straight. Kimber defends to the inside line again. Can Curl hold it right round the outside? No. But Hodgson has got through in a third place. So Hodgson has made the bid on Sean Butcher. So this is going to be mighty exciting from here on in. As Kimber leads the race, Danny Curl in second, Oliver Hodgson now up to third position. And meanwhile, Thomas Turner has made the move on Clayton Ravenscroft, who is falling into the clutches of Alex Pendlebury. The British Championship charge for Ravenscroft is tumbling about his ears right now. Pendlebury is now giving him a massive hurry up, and we are about to go into the penultimate lap of the race. The battle is going to be ferocious now between Kimber and Curl. Kimber will hold the inside line. He'll defend again. Well, he's not quite needing to at the moment. He just pulls across a little bit to the first corner because he gained a bit of momentum there. But Danny Curl is still going to be pushing very hard. His fastest lap is fractionally quicker than Kimber's. But amazingly, to the hundredth of a second, Danny Curl has the same best lap, 43.08, as Oliver Hodgson and Sean Butcher behind him. Faster than all of them, incidentally, is Thomas Turner. And he is currently the man with the fastest lap of the race. Ravenscroft 6th, Pendlebury 7th, but this is it. Now or never for Danny Curl, and he knows it. As he comes out of Luna Bend, they're only going to have one more lap of this Three Sisters circuit. Here we go. Battle for the victory. Kimber, Curl and Hodgson, with Butcher in firing distance if needed. Kimber defends to the inside line. Curl and Hodgson are right there. If they want to win this race, they're going to have to push it, and push it like stink over the valley. Hodgson has another look. He can't get there. So Mark Kimber runs in front of Danny Curl down the old pit straight. He's not close enough to make the move on Kimber. I think Danny Curl is going to play the long game here. Second position is a mighty fine result after his win yesterday, and that will put him into championship winning contention as we head to the season finale at Wilton Mill. But this has all been about the man in front of him. Mark Kimber comes out of Luna Bend flat to the throttle and wins at Three Sisters. Fantastic! Curl is second, Hodgson is third from Sean Butcher. And a brilliant run from Thomas Turner in fifth position means he now leads the Drivers' Championship by 6 points before drop scores to Clayton Ravenscroft in sixth on the road. Alex Pendlebury seventh from Teddy Pritchard, Williams and Morgan Porter. Then Jack Gordon and Louis Westover, Archie Tillett and Cole Kilner, Nelson King, Jensen Brown, Rory Hudson, Matt Armstrong, Alexander Wang, Gus Lawrence, Derek Morgan, Caleb Marshall, Thomas Wood, Eduardo Cossetang, Callum Driscoll from Ben Hodge and Abigail Ross, Richard Faulkner, Henry Ayres and Josh Graham. With the three retirements from the race, Matthew Hudson, Rufus Hunt and Lee Chamberlain, we have a new championship leader in Thomas Turner, but Danny Curl in second is not done yet. Mark Kimber, though, taking a fantastic victory ahead of them all. Well, 22 laps of fast, ferocious racing around Three Sisters, and we definitely had a spectacular result. Kimber in front of Curl and Hodgson is definitely going to spice things up heading to Wilton Mill, the season finale next month. So we're going to have an absolutely fantastic end to the season there. But Senior X30 has come to a very exciting crescendo, and what a battle it's turned out to be. But there's going to be more where that came from as we continue the races this afternoon, as we move from the Senior X30 final into the action and drama again, as we now get ourselves ready for the next race on the bill. And that, of course, is the IAME Cadet Final. My goodness me, we are just getting started for the drama and tension.
Hi, I'm Tom Ingram, and you're listening to Downforce Radio.
Hi, I'm Jacques Villeneuve, you're listening to Downforce Radio.
Hi, I'm Bruno Senna, you're listening to Downforce Radio.
Hi, I'm Chris, and you're listening to Downforce Radio.
Hi, I'm Landon Norris, and you're listening to Downforce Radio.
Talk the city's a part of my design.
Hi, I'm Tom Ingram, and you're listening to Downforce Radio.
Hi, I'm Jacques Villeneuve. You're listening to Downforce Radio.
Hi, I'm Bruno Senna. You're listening to Downforce Radio.
Hi, I'm Chris Hoy, and you're listening to Downforce Radio.
Hi, I'm Landon Norris, and you're listening to Downforce Radio.
You're listening to Race Day Live on Downforce UK, brought to you by Clapham North MOT, Motorsport Days Live, Watch Hospitality, and Trade Price Cars.
Well, guess what, folks? We get to do it all again as the IAME Cadet drivers now make their way out onto the circuit. And it has been mighty close again here at Three Sisters, with these guys in particular are finding it tougher than anybody else out on the circuit. You've got to remember that these guys are still at the beginning of their motor racing careers, an IAME Cadet, aged between 8 and 12. And obviously these guys are finding it very hard indeed to cope with the 30 degrees Celsius temperatures. A lot of them have been getting out of the carts at the end of the heats, which of course were only 6 minutes plus the additional lap, 8 minutes, sorry, plus the additional lap, sweating bucket loads. I have a feeling that there's going to be half of the drivers on the grid who will have lost half their actual body weight by the end of the final. They are pushing so hard, considering how much adhesion and how much aggression they are having to put into the circuit. But fair play to them. It's not an easy task when you are very young indeed and trying to put yourself up at the front end of a racing car field. And these guys doing an absolutely amazing job. Karting in 30 degrees temperatures plus is very, very difficult indeed. And then when you take into account that you're barely in secondary school, some of these guys are still very much in the middle of their primary school years. And they've obviously got the helmet on, the gloves, the boots, the Nomex underwear, the race suit. And then obviously they're pushing the limits of about 40 miles an hour or so as they go around the circuit for 15 minutes, plus the additional lap on top of that as well. It's basically like going flat out in a sauna. And these guys are working very hard indeed to keep on top of it. But I tell you what, the racing as a result of that has been spectacular. There is at least a dozen drivers who could take the victory in this one. It's been mighty close here, potentially in terms of lap times, even closer than yesterday was, as these guys are obviously finding that the change in forecast from 24 hours ago, it was hot yesterday. Today, it's just a different lead, but the racers are giving it their absolute, and they are pushing very hard indeed to get to the podium. Multiple teams and multiple drivers have the ability to get up to that point as well. So we're going to see plenty of top talented drivers up at the sharp end of the field. The Fusion Motorsport, Oliver Rowland Motorsport war continues up at the front end of the field, with Vinny Phillips putting in a fantastic performance across his heat, as too did his teammate, the Japanese star Kin Nakamura Berta, who of course leads the Drivers' Championship coming into these last two weekends of the IAME season. And it's very, very tight in terms of the evenness of competition between those two here this weekend. Harley Keeble and Harry Jr. Burgoyne, though, have definitely been holding a candle to them up at the front end of the field. And both those drivers have shown exceptional speed around this Three Sisters circuit. Keeble, a little bit easier in terms of the luck on this Sunday afternoon, but Harry Jr. Burgoyne has never backed down from the fight and has always put himself right up into the sharp end of the fray. And from the outside of the second row, he has a genuine chance of this victory, but then so do at least another 8 or 9 drivers tucked in behind them. But the great thing about this Three Sisters circuit for the IAME Cadets is that with the carts being smaller, there is a lot more racetrack to play with. And there's a few more overtaking opportunities in cadet that drivers just can't manage in junior, senior and mini. So this is obviously a very exciting battle for the youngsters in IAME Cadet. The battle has been raging around this Three Sisters circuit, a circuit famous for giving IAME Cadet drivers or cadet drivers in various disciplines a route from Three Sisters up to the world of Formula One. Three drivers from cadets who were successful in the British Kart Championships at this very circuit include Lewis Hamilton, George Russell and Lando Norris, all now currently in Formula One. An absolutely incredible way to make their way up through the ranks. It's taken them a few years. It'll take some of these a few years too. But just think for one moment that there could be a handful of drivers on this grid that could well be on the grid at Monaco, Indianapolis or Le Mans years from now. That's the kind of talent we have in the British Kart Championship, and they come from far and wide. Represented here this weekend and in the IAME classes, we have drivers from pretty much all six continents around the globe in one way, shape or form. Even on this particular grid, we have drivers from further afield, from across Europe, from North and South America, and over, of course, into Asia as well. An amazing plethora of talent. And over the course of the season, I'm fairly sure it's fair to say that in the IAME paddock alone, we have had representatives from all six continents. From Africa, from Asia, from Australasia, and even from North and South America, as well as from various parts of Europe. In IAME Cadet, the battle has been incredibly tight. But Kia Nakamura Berta and Vinny Phillips on that front row of the starting grid are going to be very hard to beat. Harley Keeble, Harry Jr. Burgoyne and Brandon Carr for the Oliver Rowland Motorsport team will naturally give them a very tough run for their money. But with just 11 points separating Nakamura Berta and Harley Keeble at the front end of the championship now, this is going to be worth a watch. Kia Nakamura Berta on pole position from Vinny Phillips. Second row of the grid is Harley Keeble and Harry Jr. Burgoyne. Brandon Carr and Archie Clark from Maximus Hall and Ethan Jeff Hall. Happy birthday, Ethan. Alex O'Grady and Lewis Werrell, then Ella Stevens and Cahal Clark, Nathan Tai and Finn McLaughlin, Macaulay Bishop and Dan Sofronea, Sebastian Minns and Roman Kamyab on his debut, Hadi Mamassi and Lewis Bird from William Antrobus and Sky Parker, George Edgar, Eden Spanswick, Joey Brown and Jack Cunningham, who looks like he has made it out for the final after his incident in qualifying. He missed the heats, but it looks as though he has made it out in time for the final race of the day. So, Kia Nakamura Berta has an opportunity to extend his lead in the championship, which is currently at 11 points. On his birthday, Ethan Jeff Hall has made massive progress and moved himself into third place in the Drivers' Championship, just a point ahead of Harry Jr. Burgoyne. Five more back is Maximus Hall, and 10 further back is Archie Clark, now in the top six in his first full season in the British Kart Championship. But there is still plenty more to be written about this season, and these competitors know just how hard it's going to be. Kia Nakamura Berta and Vinny Phillips on the front row of the grid from Harley Keeble and Harry Jr. Burgoyne, Brandon Carr and Archie Clark, Maximus Hall and Ethan Jeff Hall on his 11th birthday, Alex O'Grady and Lewis Werrell in the top 10, yesterday's heat winner and pole position driver Ella Stevens alongside Cahal Clark, Tai and McLaughlin, Bishop and Sofronea. IAME Cadet is underway. Not this time. False start by the look of it. So the drivers will come through one more time around the circuit as they try to put themselves into a neat rhythm. But it's always very tough in IAME Cadet. The drivers know just what's at stake, and they will obviously battle for supremacy when they come around at the end of this formation lap. But with a very tough field of 26 drivers in IAME Cadet in the British Championship, it's obviously going to be mighty tight at the front end of the field. Rowland with three representatives from each team, Maximus Hall and Ethan Jeff Hall withholding the honours for the PMR driver programme and Strawberry Racing. And then, of course, Alex O'Grady pushing very hard along with Lewis Werrell, continuing the Fusion ORM title battle. 30 degrees air temperature, 15 minutes plus one lap on the clock, and what a grid it's going to be. Kia Nakamura Berta and Vinny Phillips on the front row, Harley Keeble and Harry Jr. Burgoyne on the second row, Brandon Carr and Archie Clark, Maximus Hall and Ethan Jeff Hall, Alex O'Grady and Lewis Werrell in the top 10, with Ella Stevens, who won in the heat yesterday and got the pole position from yesterday's qualifying, alongside the new Fusion driver, Cahal Clark. Here we go, engine revs will rise. Is it going to be a clean start this time? Yes, it is, and we charge for the first corner. So Vinny Phillips is going to be on the left side as they make their way run to the first corner and round the outside. Vinny Phillips gets the lead. Brilliant start as he goes the long way round and takes the lead off Kia Nakamura Berta. They go up the valley for the first time, and there's already a really strong battle up at the front end of the field as Harley Keeble is trying to get his way into second position early doors. No, that's Harry Jr. Burgoyne who's made the jump into third position. A great start then from the left side of the grid as Vinny Phillips has got into the lead and Kia Nakamura Berta down to second. Harry Jr. Burgoyne is up to third in front of Harley Keeble, and then it's Archie Clark in front of Maximus Hall, Ethan Jeff Hall and Alex O'Grady. Not a great start for Brandon Carr. as the field makes its way through to Luna for the first time. They go through the long flowing right hand. He goes up the inside. Kia Nakamura Berta takes the lead. Harry Jr. Burgoyne's going to get stuck in there as well. He's in a second place. Harley Keeble now working with Vinny Phillips down the home straight and is looking for a move up into third position. Keeble makes the lunge and into third position. Vinny Phillips down from the lead to fourth in the shape of two corners. Not the easiest of things to take for Vinny Phillips, but he's got plenty of time to fight back. 13 minutes and 51 seconds, of course, on the clock as Harry Jr. Burgoyne now steps up the attack to close up on Kia Nakamura Berta, the new race leader. And he really wants to get the victory in the final here in this one. He had a tough day at the office yesterday, not the result he wanted. But Kia Nakamura Berta now charging forward to try and get up onto the top step of the podium. But the two ORM twins, Harry Jr. Burgoyne and Harley Keeble, are going to be pushing very hard out of Luna. They'll work together in collaboration. They might well sweep past Kia Nakamura Berta before he even knows what's hit them. Here they come, out of position. Harry Jr. Burgoyne gets the move up the inside. Harley Keeble's going to go with him, and they are first and second. Nice move from the two teammates there. Harry Jr. Burgoyne then hits the front in front of Harley Keeble and Kia Nakamura Berta down to third. Over the top of the valley. Fourth position. Still Vinny Phillips. Now up to fifth comes Maximus Hall. He's got the move on Archie Clark and they are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. Up the inside. Nakamura Berta makes the move on Keeble. The door's still open. Vinny Phillips trying to get there. Keeble will not let him go. He gets back to the inside. Holds the place. Up on the curb goes Keeble. Up on the curb goes Phillips, I should say. Maximus Hall's through. Archie Clark's through. Ethan Jeff Hall and Alex O'Grady are through. So Vinny Phillips on the curbs has to hang back. And unfortunately, that drops him down to eighth place. But there's a long, long way still to go down the straight. Harry Jr. Burgoyne and Kia Nakamura Berta starting to stretch away. Up the inside, that's Archie Clark making the move for fourth position on Maximus Hall. And Ethan Jeff Hall is to his right. He nearly gets through there. Goodness me, that would have been a big move on his 11th birthday. Great racing from Ethan Jeff Hall. So they come through to the hairpin onto the old pit straight again. And a very exciting battle up front as Harry Jr. Burgoyne has Kia Nakamura Berta all over the back of him. Harley Keeble's not done yet in third place. He wants a piece of this. Meanwhile, up to fourth has come Ethan Jeff Hall on the inside of Maximus Hall. So Maximus Hall down to fifth. Then it's Archie Clark, Alex O'Grady and Vinny Phillips. Then it is Brandon Carr and Nathan Tye, the teammates at Oliver Road and Motorsport in front of the Irishman Finn McLaughlin, McCauley Bishop. And then it looks like Lewis Werrell, Cahal Clark and Ella Stevens from Dan Sofrenea, Roman Kanyab, Lewis Bird, Sebastian Mins and Will Antrobus. So the three leaders are now on their own up front. Harley Keeble trying again to work with teammate Harry Jr. Burgoyne to sweep past Kia Nakamura Berta. Well, the Japanese driver's done such an amazing job in this 2019 campaign. If it finishes like this, he will have a very strong lead indeed. It was 11 points. It's now going to end up being something like 16 points, I think it will be, by the end of this race. If he stays where he is, he has to defend to the inside line of the hairpin as Harry Jr. Burgoyne has a bit of a look to come through on the undercut. But Harry Jr. Burgoyne unable to get there. They ride those curbs big time as Vinny Phillips now has to defend to the inside line to try and shake off Brandon Carr and Nathan Tye. Brandon Carr's going to get up the inside. He gets through. Vinny Phillips gets back onto the inside of him to retake the place. So great racing in the midfield as well as at the front. And more problems for Eden Spanswick after an amazing day yesterday. He's now struggling. Nakamura Berta trying to look either way to see where his rivals are going. Harley Keeble up the inside of Harry Jr. Burgoyne as a result. And Burgoyne doesn't take the lead. He slips to third as Keeble now takes up the challenge and leads the cavalry after his main championship opposition. And up the inside, that's Ethan Jeff Hall. What a move into the S's. Up into third position. Absolutely stellar move. And now it's going to be three wide in the next corner. Amazing from Maximus Hall. Up into fourth place. Archie Clark trying to make his bid to get through. As up the order has come, Archie Clark to fifth position. But Ethan Jeff Hall is now right on the back. And the GP plate, Kia Nakamura Berta, is now down behind Clark. So it's the two ORM carts, Keeble and Burgoyne in first and second. Third is now Ethan Jeff Hall. Fourth is Maximus Hall. Fifth is Archie Clark. Sixth is Kia Nakamura Berta in front of Alex O'Grady. Here comes Nakamura Berta on the inside of his teammate Archie Clark. And he gets the place back into fifth. But now he's got a very tough race in front of him. Up to fifth place, but Ethan Jeff Hall is going for broke. He's come so close so many times to the victory. He now really wants it. On his 11th birthday, he would absolutely love to go into September. And of course, he will start secondary school in a couple of weeks' time. but he is going to take a massive trophy home if he keeps this kind of pace up. Harley Keeble and Harry Jr. Burgoyne still working together at the front end of the field, but they know that Ethan Sheffall is there. Keaton Nakamura-Berta's passed Maximus Hall now, up into fourth place, so he's back on the tail. So this is going to be a mighty race battle. And we've got some tussles further back down the order, one or two drivers tangling. But now look at this, a massive swap down the home straight. Keaton Nakamura-Berta is going to assist Ethan Sheffall to the lead of the race. Ethan Sheffall takes the lead. Nakamura-Berta up to second. Keeble and Burgoyne down to third and fourth. Maximus Hall in fifth position now. So this is one heck of a fight we're getting treated to now. They come onto the old pit straight once again. And the birthday boy leads the race. But for how much longer? Kia Nakamura-Berta trying to get through. Jeff Hall defends like crazy. And the Japanese driver can't get by. Now, if Harley Keeble can make the move to get past the Japanese, there's a strong chance that this fight will continue again. But still, the battle continues on. And Harley Keeble trying to make his way back past Kia Nakamura-Berta, who goes for the inside of Ethan Jeff Hall. He sticks his nose to the inside. Ethan Jeff Hall trying to squeeze him. There's a little bit of a nudge between them. And Keeble's going to get past them both. So too is Burgoyne, Hall, Clark, O'Grady. They're all going to storm past. And now they're weaving down to the first corner. A big lunge up the inside. And Archie Clark gets in a second place. Brilliant bit of racecraft in behind Keeble. Archie Clark is now in second place. Absolutely heroic racing, but there's a massive tussle for the fifth position behind them. Harry Jr. Burgoyne's made his way to third, trying to tuck in behind Archie Clark, and Maximus Hall's in there in fourth place. But Kia Nakamura-Berta et al. Have all fallen back by a few car lengths, and that looks to me like Brandon Carr has now moved his way up into fifth position. Great comeback from Brandon. He's now defending to Vinnie Phillips, Macaulay Bishop, and the 22 is in the mix there as well. So what's happened to the drivers further back? We've had a couple of drivers down the order. Nakamura-Berta's run down to the very back of the field. That is a disaster for the Japanese driver. And the championship could be blown wide open here. In fact, if the race finishes like this, Harley Keeble is going to take the lead of the championship. So Keeble from Clark and Burgoyne. Maximus Hall in fourth position. Brandon Carr is next up. Something must have happened on the valley there. I didn't see it, unfortunately, from my vantage point. But it's definitely shaking things up. And now fifth position, Brandon Carr trying to hang on in front of Bishop, Clark, Phillips and Maximus Hall in there. Sorry, Ethan Jeff Hall in there. Maximus Hall's in fourth position, of course. They're still jockeying for position. But Archie Clark is now behind Harley Keeble, fighting for his first win in the British Championship. If he could get it now, it really would be spectacular. But there's still a tough race in prospect for a lot of the drivers in the field. As the international contingent going side by side there. Kia Nakamura-Berta battling with Hadi Mamassi to make up progress. Here comes the move from the inside as Harley Keeble is going to be joined by Harry Jr. Burgoyne. The Scotsman back into second place. The O-plate moves up. So some big movements down the order. Meanwhile, problems for Eden Spanswick. He has retired from the race with mechanical problems. A real shame after his amazing performance yesterday. But it's not to be again today. The drivers make their way through, battling for the victory. Keeble, Burgoyne, Clark and Hall. So a very exciting battle for Harley Keeble as he has the potential to take the lead of the Drivers' Championship with this one. He'll be 11 points clear of Kia Nakamura-Berta. It was that position when they came into the race. So that just shows you how tough it is. Meanwhile, Macaulay Bishop is storming his way up into the top five, trying to battle with Vinnie Phillips and Brandon Carr. Macaulay Bishop, he's having an absolute stormer as he fights his way back, but he's been squeezed on the way out of Luna, and he's going to drop down to the back of the queue. So there's a great race going on for fifth position, but a great race for the lead as well, as Keeble and Burgoyne run first and second. Archie Clark is third and Maximus Hall in fourth, and they look like the drivers fighting for the victory. For fifth place, it's tough. Phillips, Jeff Hall, Carr, Ty, McLaughlin, Stevens and Bishop from O'Grady and Cahal Clark, with Lewis Werrell in the mix there as well. So an absolutely heroic race for first and for fifth. Side by side, that is Alex O'Grady trying to get past his teammate Ella Stevens. And Stevens has been squeezed out wide there. Bishop gets through. So does the 22 of Cahal Clark and Lewis Werrell. So Ella Stevens goes back to the back of the queue. But the leaders are coming through again. Harry Jr. Burgoyne trying to work his magic with Harley Keeble up front. An amazing championship showdown in the offing now. As they come through to the S's at the beginning of the next lap. And up over the valley, It is Kiebel and Burgoyne, first and second, having a terrific run. But Nakamura Berta is charging his way back through the field. He's up to 19th now at the line. And that drops the deficit to 10 points on Harley Kiebel. But Kiebel would so dearly love to win this race with his main championship opposition down the order and out of the top 10. So this is going to be a thrilling encounter to the final stages of the race. And with 4 minutes and five on the clock, it is going to be absolutely euphoric at the front end of the field. Phillips in fifth, Ethan Jeff Hall sixth. Then it's Brandon Carr in front of Finn McLaughlin and Nathan Tye, who are battling away for eighth place. And in the top 10 at the moment, it is Macaulay Bishop to the lead of the race. The top four is still nose to tail, no change of position. Ethan Jeff Hall just working with the man in front of him, that is Vinny Phillips, to try and close up on the leading four. But the quartet up front is definitely starting to dissipate away from the field. 5.5 seconds clear. Harry Jr. Burgoyne's playing the smart game here in second place. He's working with his teammate Harley Kiebel to get away, with Archie Clark having to defend from Maximus Hall. So the battle's still going strong up front. Harry Jr. Burgoyne pushing very hard indeed now. He wants to get the move on Harley Kiebel. And the O-plate is pushing hard through to the left-hander, into Luna, through the right-hand hairpin. Back on the power and out of that long flowing right-hander and onto the home straight again. Harry Jr. Burgoyne will now start to think about taking the lead if he wants to win this race himself. 3 minutes to go. He's not going to go for the move into the first corner. He's got time to kill yet. An amazing squabble for seventh place now. Carp, McLaughlin, Ty, Bishop, O'Grady, Clark, Stevens, Werrell, and I think Lewis Bird now creeping into the battle as well. So a really exciting battle. Oh, now Brandon Carr has been given a warning flag for his part on the last lap. Not sure what it was, but he's certainly done something the officials aren't keen on. But now Harley Kiebel is only 8 points ahead of Nakamura Berta if it stays like this, because Nakamura Berta has made up another couple of places in the last lap or so. He's up into 17th place. If he makes up a few more, then he's going to have a lesser gap to lose. But this is going to be a very exciting showdown. 2 minutes and 10 on the clock, plus the additional bonus lap. And we have got such great racing to come. The O-plate, Harry Jr. Burgoyne, doesn't go for the move yet. Great news for Archie Clark. He's just able to tow them down the straight. And now as they come up and over the valley, there's a strong chance of an opportunistic move. Still a great squabble in the midfield as Macaulay Bishop picks up a couple of places. Battling away with Alex O'Grady and Finn McLaughlin. And in that mix there as well is Cahal Clark. But the leaders are going down the pit straight. Maximus Hall is struggling to stay with them, but in fourth position, he's in the box seat if anything kicks off in front. So this could still be a very strong result for Maximus Hall in fourth position. For fifth and sixth, Vinny Phillips and Ethan Jeff Hall are in cahoots now as they try and close up on the leading quartet. But out of the Luna Bend hairpin once again, it is now Harley Kiebel versus Harry Jr. Burgoyne. They've got a little bit of space to Archie Clark as they come over the line, a minute and 16 or so on the clock. As now, Harry Jr. Burgoyne will start thinking about the overtake, but it'll be the next lap he makes his first bid. So here they come down the straight. They're starting to separate two by two. Hurrah, as they pick their battles now into the first corner. A couple of drivers going for a move or two. And that is Lewis Werrell picking off Ellis Stevens in the first corner. A warning flag goes out this time to Macaulay Bishop, the privateer, who is mixing it up at the front end of the field. But Harley Kiebel still hangs on from Harry Jr. Burgoyne. But Archie Clark's not done yet in third place. He is catching them up again. And he knows that with two laps to go, he's got a great chance to win his first final in the British Kart Championship. Third position for him at the moment. He just follows in behind the ORM twins. He was the leading fusion over the line yesterday. He's got a great chance to do it again today. Here comes Harley Kiebel. Harry Jr. Burgoyne looks one way and the other. But Archie Clark might commit to the move anyway. Into the first corner he goes for it and gets second place. Archie Clark in a P2. So now there's just one more to pass before he leads the race for the first time this week. He's gone for it already and he's through. Archie Clark leads at Three Sisters. Absolutely amazing. He has taken the lead and now Junior Burgoyne's back up the inside. He takes the lead now. A fantastic squabble between the leading three. So Kiebel was leading, then Archie Clark got him, and now Burgoyne has taken the lead back. And now they are squabbling for supremacy with one lap to go here at Three Sisters. It's a three-way scrap for the victory and any one of them could take it. out of the final turn. The last lap board comes up. Burgoyne, Clark and Keeble down the home straight. Burgoyne is married to the inside line as he holds on. Keeble trying to come around the outside of Archie Clark. Tucks back in. He's not going to get the overtake. They come up and over the top of the valley. Can Archie Clark make another bold move here? Up on the inside of Burgoyne. Not this time. He has to go back to the old pit straight. So down the old pit straight, Burgoyne will be in defensive mode to the inside line. Clark is looking for a way to come through. Keeble's going to try and get the switch back. Round the outside, he goes for the move to the inside of Archie Clark and grabs second place back. Brilliant bit of driving, but that's enough for Burgoyne, surely. Burgoyne has got plenty of space now. Surely he's got enough of a gap. Clark is going to have one more crack at Keeble, but it's going to be for second place out of the final hairpin. Harry Jr. Burgoyne has done it in style. He wins the Three Sisters. Two hands in the air. Absolutely sensational victory. And that elevates Burgoyne to third in the Drivers' Championship with 1 weekend to go. He's right in the hunt for the title race now. Amazing. Keeble in second. Archie Clark takes his first British Car Championship podium in third position. Absolutely magnificent racing. Maximus Hall is fourth. Vinnie Phillips comes home in fifth in front of Ethan Jeff Hall. Nathan Tye in seventh place. What a fight back in front of Macaulay Bishop, who made up 7 places to eighth. He's the hard charger. Alex O'Grady is ninth and Brandon Carr in 10th from Cahal Clark and Lewis Werrell. Finn McLaughlin is 13th in front of Ella Stevens. Then Lewis Bird and Kian Nakamura-Berta, only 16th. And that means Keeble's lead in the Drivers' Championship is only 4 points. 17th is Dan Sofroniere. 18th is Roman Kamyab from Will Antrobus and Sebastian Mins. Hadi Mamassi and Jack Cunningham from George Edgar, Sky Parker and Joey Brown with the one retirement, Eden Spanswick. Amazing racing, but Harry Jr. Burgoyne wins at Three Sisters. Truly sensational racing yet again in the British Car Championships and IAME Cadet. And I have to say, with Mini X30 up next, we've seen some royal battles from them over the course of the season. But they're going to have to do a heck of a lot of work to live up to that kind of euphoria. Absolutely amazing from Mini X30. But now we have got some brilliant racing to come from them. They've had 2 great heats, but we have the finals completed in Junior and Senior X30 and an Army Cadet. Just 1 to go, and that, of course, is from Mini X30.
There is no terrible way to win. There is only winning.
Let me drive. I will make a fool out of you.
Every one of us has to find a reason to do this. You do it because you're driven.
I was beginning to think I'd never be anything more than a piston-happy, lead-foot punk. Then this starts to happen.
Somebody put it in your mind you got to be perfect every time out or you're a failure. Well, forget that. Just forget it.
You ready to put away your toys and grow up? Are you ready to make more money in 1 year than your father made in his whole life? Are you ready to become a real race car driver?
When I won, it was probably the last time I ever felt pure victory.
Because I'm quicker than all of you.
And if you no longer go for a gap that exists, you're no longer a racing driver.
But hell, isn't that what we're in this for? To stare death in the face and to cheat it? Come on, there's nobility in that. It's like being knights.
No pressure. Nobody breathing down my back, just driving because I left it pure.
A lot of people go through life doing things badly. Racing is important to men who do it well. When you're racing, it's life. Anything that happens before or after, it's just waiting.
I just hope when you do, that I'm there to see it.
Racing. That's the name of the game, isn't it? Win or lose, put up or shut.
Fine. Then let's race.
Till the end. just want to tell you nothing you don't want to hear. All I want is for you to say, oh, why don't you just take me where I've never been before? I know you want to hear me catch my breath. I love you till the end. I love you till the end.
Hi, I'm Tom Ingham, and you're listening to Downforce Radio.
Hi, I'm Jacques Villeneuve, you're listening to Downforce Radio.
Hi, I'm Bruno Senna, you're listening to Downforce Radio.
Hi, I'm Chris Hoy, and you're listening to Downforce Radio.
Hi, I'm Landon Norris, and you're listening to Downforce Radio.
You're listening to Race Day Live on Downforce UK, brought to you by Clapham North MOT, Motorsport Days Live, Stopwatch Hospitality, and Trade Price Cars.
The final race of the weekend is about to get underway. Mini X30 final here at Three Sisters in what is the 10th round of the Motorsport UK British Car Championships in Mini X30. We've seen some fantastic races in Junior X30, Senior X30 and IAME Cadet. Now we finish up with the Mini X30 duel, and this title fight looks like it could go all the way to the death as well, with so many changes in terms of the running order over the course of the season. It is going to be a very close fight for supremacy heading to Wilton Mill, the season finale. Both Oliver Greenall and Theo Mercouris, the two leaders in the Drivers' Championship coming into this point, have struggled at various points over the course of the weekend. They've not been the ones on the fast form. That has fallen the way, certainly in this particular race weekend, of Luke Watts, who has been mighty quick over the course of yesterday and who's been a heat winner over the course of the day so far as well. so he's definitely one to watch. And if he gains big ground on both Greenall and Mercuris, it sets us up for what is potentially a three-way title fight heading to the championship finale at Wilton Mill. Although don't count out the likes of both Jessica Edgar and Bart Harrison. Both drivers have put in a fantastic performance over the course of the weekend as well, and they will hope that their point scores elevate them towards what could end up being a potentially, even essentially, a five-way title fight heading to the season finale at Wilton Mill. And it's very, very close. It all comes down essentially to drop scores. Coming into the weekend, it was Oliver Greenall who had the advantage on that front by 13 points to Theo Mercuris. But he made a gain on Greenall yesterday, from the best of my knowledge. And then, of course, we come into the final today, and it's going to be a little bit tougher. Greenall seems to have had the edge in terms of results, if not pace. But it's very close between those two drivers in terms of raw one-lap potential. Theo Mercuris was very quick indeed yesterday, and obviously had the pole position from time qualifying, but there's a lot of great racing to come before we really conclude who is going to be the one that walks into the championship finale at Wilton Mill with the best possible shot of becoming 2019 Mini X30 British Kart Champion. But it will be a very tough fight from here on in. The 10 remaining drivers in the race, because we're told that Gabriel Stilp will not be able to take up the start. We're not entirely sure for the reason that is, but the two main title protagonists, Oliver Greenall starting in fourth and Theo Mercuris starting in fifth, will be right up close to each other heading into this 15-minute final. 15 minutes plus one lap, of course, so it's going to go right the way to the end, with the title fight very much in the offing as well. Luke Watts and Bart Harrison trying to make as many gains as they possibly can from first and third, and the Welshman Olivier Algieri is going to be a hard one to battle with in second on the grid. They go around for their green flag lap, and now it is time for the final race of the weekend here at Three Sisters. Luke Watts on pole position. Olivier Algieri in second. Bart Harrison is third from Oliver Greenall in P4. Then Theo Mercuris and Jessica Edgar on the third row of the grid from Aidan Lyne and Evan Brown, with the last two drivers in, Ed Pearson and Ashton Parsons. Sadly, there will be no start to the race as far as we gather from Gabriel Stilp, although that does look like it might be him there in the 42. Yes, it is. I was told he wasn't going to be able to take up the start, but it looks as though now he is able to take it. So that is great news. Really good to see that Gabriel Stilp and the crop promotion team have got him out there in 11th position. So it will be a full capacity field, but it's very hard to tell who is going to get the best of this, because obviously the field is mighty close in Mini X30. There may not be as many of them as there are the other classes, but the racing is certainly very tight indeed at the top end of this grid. And Luke Watts versus Olivier Algieri has already been the talk of a lot of excitement over the course of the day. Those two are fighting very hard indeed. Algieri to improve his points tally on drop scores. He has 344 coming into the weekend, although he's going to have a better tally by the time they leave this after his performance yesterday. And starting from second, he has a good chance to improve that again today. Luke Watts in pole position from Olivier Algieri, Bart Harrison and Oliver Greenall, then Theo Mercuris, Jess Edgar, Lyne, Brown, Pearson, Parsons and Stilp. Let's go racing in Mini X30, lights out straight away and we're racing. Here are Three Sisters, charged out of the first corner, and it looks like it's going to be a very strong challenge to that first corner from Algieri, but he can't overhaul Watts. As they go through the first corner and up the valley, it is Luke Watts for the Kato Motorsport squad that holds the lead in the early doors. Into the right-hander and along the old pit straight. So Luke Watts has the advantage over Olivier Algieri. Up to third position, that is Bart Harrison, who has held off the momentum from his teammate Oliver Greenall. But Theo Mercuris is right there in fifth position. Jessica Edgar still sixth. Ed Pearson has elevated himself to seventh place off the start in front of Aidan Lyne. And then it is Evan Brown, Gabriel Stilp and Ashton Parsons who finish off the field. But Luke Watts is hanging on to this advantage for the moment. He's going to find it tough to remain in first position with Algieri breathing down his neck. Algieri is giving him a bit of support down to the first corner. He wants to stretch out the gap, leaving these two, Bart Harrison and Ollie Greenall, in their wake. If the race were to finish like this, then Greenall would still lead the championship on 603 points. But thanks to his great performance this weekend, Luke Watts would now move into second place. That's not taking into account drop scores. Greenall makes the move on his teammate. That has made a few changes. And so now Greenall up to third past Harrison. And Theo Mercuris is now the next one stepping up the attack. He's got a really good run as they come up towards Luna Bend. He's trying to make his presence felt in the top six. Jess Edgar there in sixth position as well. Don't count her out of a fight for the championship. She's only 23 points back from Greenall before dropped scores if it stays like this. And it won't stay like this for long. Mercuris makes a brilliant lunge up into third position up the way to the first corner. Theo Mercuris pulls it out of the block again and into third place behind the two leaders, Watson Algieri. So now Mercuris has the trio of fusion carts behind him in his wake. Greenall in fourth, Harrison in fifth, and Edgar in sixth. But Mercuris took full advantage of the battle between the fusions and decides to go for the move. So it looks to me as though that's actually Jesse Edgar up to fourth place. My apologies. So Edgar has made the move on Greenall and also her teammate Bart Harrison. But that has allowed Theo Mercuris up in a third position. And that changes things pretty dramatically. Now he goes for second. He's going to make the move on his teammate Algieri. He gets through. Edgar's trying to get through in a third. She doesn't make it. So she's there in fourth still. Now, as far as I can tell, that's going to put Theo Mercuris on 597 in the points tally. Greenall on 602. So that really does tighten things up. If Mercuris can get past Watts, not only does he retain second in the Drivers' Championship, tied with Watts at the present moment as they are on 595. So if he gets past Watts, he'll take the lead of that battle for second. But he'll also tighten up his grip on Greenall, who's in third place at the moment. So Greenall's made up some places. Now that means that Greenall is up from fifth to third. So that will put him on 604 points. So that helps him out quite a lot. But he's not done yet because here comes Algieri. Algieri trying to get through on Greenall to tighten his way through in a third position. Mercuris is still pushing very hard up and over the top of the valley. And Mercuris is now into second place in the standings on 597 with Watts in third on 595. So Mercuris really could do with getting through. If he can, then he's going to be on 602 with Greenall on 604. Now, that's definitely going to give us an amazing title fight at Wilton Mill. If Mercuris can get past Watts and win, it will just be 2 points between the two leading drivers in the championship. But Algieri wants to write his own story here. He's going to try and get on terms with Ollie Greenall. So the two crop promotion drivers trying to move up a place. If Mercuris does so, he takes the lead. If Algieri does so, he gets in a third. And in fifth position, Jess Edgar is still there waiting in the wings from Bart Harrison and Ed Pearson. So a very exciting battle still to come. And Theo Mercuris is just getting himself sat nicely in position in second place behind Luke Watts. He doesn't have to lead the race at this point. He just needs to allow Luke Watts a little bit of breathing space. And he can do all the hard work sat in the lead of the race. While Mercuris in second place just eases up, follows in his wheel tracks, studies where he's going to be vulnerable, and gets himself ready for a power play later on. Ollie Greenall, meanwhile, has got some pressure, not just from Olivia Algieri, but also from his own teammate, Jessica Edgar, as they go down the home straight. Edgar's on a good run. Here comes Algieri, and Edgar's going to use the opportunity to go through as well. So Algieri to third, Edgar to fourth, and Greenall down to fifth. Now, that is very dramatic, because that will put Greenall back down to 602. If Mercuris were to take the lead at that point, they would be dead level on points. So Greenall finishing fifth and Mercuris finishing first would tie them. But now here goes Edgar for Algieri. Greenall's going to try for it as well. Algieri does not let him through. And here comes Ed Pearson. Storms his way into fifth position. Brilliant move from Ed Pearson. There's not a lot that Greenall could do about that one. And that drops into sixth position. Now if Mercuris could take the lead off Luke Watts, he would take the lead in the Drivers' Championship before drop scores by just 1 point. So that would really set things up for a bit of a beauty at Wilton Mill. This is going to be absolutely electric. So Theo Mercuris continues to battle away. I've just recalculated. My apologies. It will put Mercuris on 600 to Greenall 601. So there would be 1 point between them regardless. But what a battle it's going to be at Wilton Mill if this result is the one we're going to stick with. I have a feeling it isn't, though, because we've still got 9 minutes on the clock plus the additional lap. And these guys are nowhere near done yet. Jess Edgar in third position in front of Algieri and Pearson. Algieri desperately trying to hang on in front of Ed Pearson, who really has got a second wind after his retirement earlier on in one of the heats. He's now charging his way forward. Watch him as he makes his bid for Algieri. He has to go right. And he gets chopped across there by Algieri. Very close indeed for Pearson. He went to the right, then went to the left. And Algieri went there as well. So that was very close indeed. Pearson just managed to get off the throttle in time. to avoid disaster there. Theo Mercuris is going to make the bid for the lead, though, on the inside of Watts. And he's through. Nice overtake from Mercuris. Brilliantly timed. And so now he takes the lead. And that puts him on 600 points if it stays like this. But Edgar is giving a massive pressure to the kart in second place, Luke Watts. Edgar wants to take second place away from Watts. Greenall down in sixth position. Mercuris is getting the hurry up from Watts and Edgar down the home straight. Across the line they come. And Mercuris is still trying to hold the lead. Here comes Edgar up the inside in a second on Watts. So Edgar is through. An absolutely brilliant performance for Jess Edgar. And I'm sure that no doubt cousin Johnny Edgar watching along on the sidelines is really enjoying the battle. Jess Edgar in second position, right in behind Theo Mercuris. Mercuris is your leader. And if it stays like this, he'll be just 1 point behind Ollie Greenall in the Drivers' Championship before dropped scores heading to Welton Mill. Dropped scores would then, of course, have to be taken into account. But Jess Edgar has absolutely pushed on the door now of Theo Mercuris. He's on the back bumper as well. That's third position. Who's that? Luke Watts charging after Jess Edgar down the home straight. Is there going to be a move for the lead? No, they're just trying to stretch out the gap to fourth place, Olivia Algieri. Ed Pearson still there in fifth. But Mercuris has got a little bit of breathing space now. Edgar went for a move and it hasn't worked. Now she's having to defend from Watts. And that's given Mercuris a bit of breathing space. Exactly what he needed to win this race at this point. There's still a long way to go. We're into the second half of the race. But a little bit of daylight between Mercuris and Edgar is a very positive sign for the crop promotion driver. Watts now needing to try and get the move on Edgar. But Watts is going to work with Edgar to close up on Mercuris. So that advantage is wiped out immediately. They come off of Luna. Mercuris holding the inside line. He's going to send Edgar to the right side. Edgar's going to pop up on the inside. And with assistance from Watts, they're both going to storm through. Edgar to the lead. Watts to second. Mercuris down to third. Brilliant bit of racecraft here at Three Sisters. I'm trying to remember the last dull race I saw on this circuit. It just provides action and drama aplenty. Absolutely terrific. Now up the inside for third. That's Algieri on his teammate Mercuris. That's going to drop him down to fourth place. Ed Pearson now trying to make the bid. He can't get through. Greenall now going to try and have a crack at Pearson. And in behind is Bart Harrison in seventh place. So an amazing tussle. And a great duel for position. But Algieri is up to third past his teammate Mercuris. So that hope of closing in down to just 1 point in the championship is done for the moment. But we're not done yet. Edgar defends to Watts to the inside line as Harrison, I think, has made the move on Greenall to get through into sixth position. They're certainly battling away the two fusions up front. And Algieri making the move on Mercuris really has given the two leaders a bit of an even break. Jess Edgar leading the way in front of Luke Watts as they battle for second position in the Drivers' Championship. If they can close up on Mercuris's tally, they have a great chance to close in. But it looks like it's going to be these four drivers fighting for the Drivers' Championship. Oliver Greenall, Theo Mercuris, Luke Watts and Jessica Edgar. If it finishes like this, the gap between the four of them before drop scores will be just 13 points. And it really will be those four fighting for supremacy as Mercuris gets up the inside of his teammate and grabs third place. Brilliant late manoeuvre from Mercuris there. He read the situation perfectly. Algieri got a bit deep into the braking zone. And Mercuris just stood on everything up the inside again. And that buys him back another point. Algieri trying again. But Mercuris more than a match as he hangs on to third place. Greenall down in sixth still. And unable to get close enough to Pearson to make an overtaking move at the moment. But Olivier Algieri will want to work with his teammate Theo Mercuris to close up on the leading two. Watts has got a good line off Luna. Jessica Edgar's going to hold the lead over the line. But I think Watts is going to try and make a bid for the lead of the race here. No, he doesn't. He thinks better of it. Meanwhile, Algieri and Pearson are both going to make a shot on Mercuris. Mercuris tangles with his teammate. Mercuris is off. Oh, no. Theo Mercuris off the circuit at the chicane. Rejoins, but down the order in ninth position. That has ruined any chance Mercuris had of winning this race. Devastating. As he and his teammate tangle there in the fight up into the first corner. That promotes Pearson to third and Greenall to fourth. That has given Greenall a bit of a breather. But for Theo Mercuris, it is devastating for his title aspirations. That has really not helped at all. So now Luke Watts all over the back of Jess Edgar as they fight for the victory alone. Pearson is third. Algieri is still having a monumental battle, this time with Bart Harrison, who closed right up on him as his teammate and him tangled up in the first corner. But Jessica Edgar has only got a couple of centimetres advantage over Luke Watts as we've got 3.5 minutes to go, plus the additional lap. Can Jess Edgar hang on for the victory? It wouldn't be her first in a final in the British Karting Championships, but at this point in the championship, it would certainly be her most critical. If it stays like this, she'll be just 1 point behind Mercouris and, incredibly, just 4 behind Watts. The title fight is definitely coming alive now. Oliver Greenall elevated to 603 points means the gap between the four would be just 15 rather than 13 heading to the final round. But again, that is before dropped scores are taken into account. The best 10 results of the season count out of the 12 in the season. So Jess Edgar wanting to take a victory to strengthen her position and authority in the Drivers' Championship. Right in there with Luke Watts. Watts is all over the back of her. He's not letting her get away. And Jess Edgar, for the Fusion Motorsport team, channeling all those years of experience. It runs thick in the blood of the Edgar Racing family. They've been racing for decades now, and Jess Edgar has just proven yet again that there must be something in the water at that end of the country, as she is the latest member of the Edgar dynasty to charge forward. Up the top of the valley, Watts is all over the back of her still. But Jess Edgar hanging on to this one over the top of the valley and up towards the chicane. In through the right-hander, down the old pit straight. Edgar is your leader. Watts second. Pearson in third place from Greenall in fourth. Then Algerian Harrison, Line, Stilp and Mercouris from Evan Brown and Ashton Parsons. That's the order. But this is the closest battle on track. The lead contention between Jess Edgar and Luke Watts. Watts still trying to edge Edgar away from Ed Pearson. A podium for Ed is definitely going to help him out. But this is where the real battle is going to be fought. Jess Edgar hugs the inside line. Can Watts drive round the outside of her? She's so strong in that first corner, Jess Edgar. Her defensive tactics are second to none in this Mini X30 category on that first corner alone. She's been absolutely resolute in holding the advantage. And now, with a couple of laps to go, she's holding the inside. Watts is going to try. Edgar squeezes him out. Well defended by Jess Edgar. Really exciting battle there as, again, she steps up to the plate and delivers in spades. Any other driver might have slung that up the inside and Edgar could have conceded there, but she is not going to lose a race so easily. Out of Luna. Edgar versus Watts again as they come over the start-finish line. Again, Edgar just bolts herself to that inside apex. And now they come through up to the first corner. Again, Edgar keeps the door firmly shut. No way of getting through. Watts tries again up the valley. Over the top of the crest. And they are on their penultimate lap, I do believe. If not, they're only going to have one additional one. Again, Edgar bolts herself to the inside line. Watts is going to be sent round the outside. He needs to maximise the undercut here. But Jess Edgar's beautiful on the acceleration out of the turn. No chance of losing the position now. Absolutely brilliant. Up towards Luna. Luke Watts has to come back at her from a little way further back. They come out of Luna Bend and back on the power. Jess Edgar, she's still running a great race here in front of Luke Watts down the straight. And again, Edgar bolts herself to the inside line. Watts is having to go the long way round. Again, Edgar squeezes him out. He nearly gets alongside that time. But as time runs down to zero, we're not quite on the last lap. So this is the penultimate lap. And that was the best chance yet Watts has had of getting past Edgar in a straight fight. And again, she's not going to let him go to the inside line. On the exit of the old pit straight, she's so good off the turn. That's where she's really strong. She's able to get back on the power at exactly the right moment, backs Luke Watts in behind her, and gets herself that cart and a half breathing space. That is how she's able to maintain this lead. She's just got to do that for one more lap of this Three Sisters circuit. Out of the final turn, down the straight, last lap board is out. Jess Edgar holds the inside line, sends Watts to the left. This time Watts is really going to step it up, and Edgar again slices back in front. No chance. Over the valley, and still they duel away. Edgar hanging on from Luke Watts. Watts tries into the S's. No, don't even think about it. There's no way through there. Edgar tries again to defend to the inside line. Watts again has to move to cover. And again, Edgar blends back off the power masterfully. No chance for Watts there. He's only got one real shot. He needs to come at Edgar from a long way back out of Luna. into the left. Sets himself up for a charge up the inside. I think he's done that well, but Edgar's going to need to chop across. She's done enough. Jessica Edgar's going to take the victory. She wins the Three Sisters. Brilliant racing. Coming of age in the British Kart Championship. We've seen a female champion in the British Kart Championship in TKM in recent years, but not in X30. Jessica Edgar may be about to get close to that. Absolutely amazing. She's now just 15 points away from Oliver Greenall in the championship lead. Jess Edgar wins from Luke Watts and Ed Pearson. Oliver Greenall is fourth from Olivier Algieri. Bayer Harrison is sixth from Gabriel Stelp. Then Aiden Line, Theo Mercouris recovers to ninth in front of Evan Brown and Ashton Parsons. And they all made it home. But now there is a four-way title fight heading to Wilton Mill between Ollie Greenall, Luke Watts, Theo Mercouris and Jess Edgar. Our winner here today, here in round 10. What a sensational day of racing. And now in all four categories, we have set up a bit of a championship showdown at Wilton Mill. No champions declared, but we're definitely going to have a sizzler in the final round of the championship on the fourth weekend of September at Wilton Mill. A massive thank you to everybody here at Three Sisters Race Circuit and the Manchester and Buxton Kart Club, who've been very supportive of us over the course of the weekend. A massive thank you to the Marshals, of course, as well. Without them, we couldn't race at all. They've been absolutely sensational all weekend long, and we couldn't do it without them. They're absolute heroes, and we are so much in debt to them. But amazing weekend and a fantastic bit of racing from each of our four classes. We've had 8 amazing finals over the course of the weekend, and we are back in action for the British Kart Championship again in a few weeks' time, when the action now heads to the next round of the championship for the TKM and Honda classes on the second weekend of September at Kimbolton. But we will continue in the IAME categories at the end of September at Wilton Mill. I'm Jake Sanson. Hope you've enjoyed all of the action. We'll continue on again in IAME for a season finale in a month's time. Bye for now.
Hi, I'm Tom Ingram, and you're listening to Downforce Radio.
Hi, I'm Jacques Villeneuve, you're listening to Downforce Radio.
Hi, I'm Bruno Senna, you're listening to Downforce Radio.
Hi, I'm Chris Hoy, and you're listening to Downforce Radio.
Hi, I'm Landon Norris, and you're listening to Downforce Radio.